Welcome and thank you for tuning into A Sound Constitution on CHLY 101.7 with Lindsay, Manisha, Nilafar, Saunas, Isaiah, and Kristen.
We are third-year nursing students at Vancouver Island University in Nanaimo. We are here working to demystify health issues in and around our community, bringing you evidence-based information about your healthcare options.
This information is for educational purposes only and does not replace the advice of your primary healthcare provider.
We like to start by acknowledging and thanking the Nanaimo First Nations, whose traditional territory we have the opportunity to learn, live, and share educational experiences on.
Good morning, CHLY listeners. This is your host, Lindsay, from A Sound Constitution. Today's show is Immunizations, Is It Worth the Shot? We'll be talking about immunizations for both children and adults and what the risks and benefits are, when to get them, and where you can get them here in Nanaimo. So stay tuned and hear all things about immunizations. According to the World Health Organization, an immunization is a process whereby a person is made immune or resistant to an infectious disease, typically by administration of a vaccine. Vaccines stimulate the body's own immune system to protect the person against subsequent infection or disease. Some of the vaccine-preventable diseases include chickenpox, diphtheria, hepatitis A, hepatitis B, HPV, influenza, measles, meningococcal disease, mumps, pertussis, also known as whooping cough, pneumococcal disease, polio, rotavirus, shingles, rubella, and tetanus. First up in the show, we're going to be talking about why immunizations are such a hot-button topic, and then bust some myths about the misconceptions about the MMR vaccine and its relation to autism. We're going to listen to a video by Immunize Canada about vaccine hesitancy.
Hi there. I'm Dr. Kirk Lykso, and I'm a pediatrician and infectious diseases specialist, and I want to help keep your family healthy. You turn to doctors and other healthcare providers because we use the most trusted and current medical knowledge to care for our patients. That's at the very core of how I provide care and why I first became a physician, and to practice medicine to keep people as healthy as possible. In the past decade or so, celebrities and other self-proclaimed health gurus have shared their views against vaccines. But their positions are not backed up by credible research, and upon examination, their positions have been refuted repeatedly by medical science, the very same source that you've trusted for your medical care. It's hard to prove a negative. It's like asking me to capture the boogeyman to show you he doesn't exist. It's impossible. Sometimes these skeptical positions, they live on, even in doctors' offices, where parents turn to us when it comes to their family's health and well-being. So why then are more parents questioning us when it comes to routine vaccines? It's a good question, so that you understand and can make an informed decision using credible sources. Parents who hear these views are often left confused and indecisive. The result is that some children don't get routine vaccinations, and their health is put at risk. Doctors and nurses have you and your child's best interests at heart. Today I'll talk about some common questions or concerns about vaccines and encourage you to continue this conversation with your doctor. I hope that you'll make the best choice for your entire family based on medical science. Every year, routine immunizations protect Canadian families and children from preventable illnesses and disease. And hey, needles aren't fun. As a parent myself, I don't like to see my child upset. But vaccines can only protect when they're used. And just like a car seat or a seat belt, if you delay or don't vaccinate, then your child misses out on that protection. Vaccines have an excellent safety record, and they're continually monitored and tested around the world and in Canada before they're approved for use. You're the proud parents of a healthy baby. Congratulations! Among all the other new routines in your life, like sleep and feeding schedules, your doctor will give you an immunization schedule. This schedule outlines when to make an appointment for your baby's first and follow-up vaccines. They start around 2 months of age. If you have already missed shots, you can still catch up. Speak to your doctor or nurse about getting them back on track. With every vaccination, you're helping your baby's immune system fight off diseases that could otherwise harm their organs, limbs, thinking, and speaking abilities. So how do vaccines work? Well, they trigger a response from your baby's immune system, which learns to recognize and then attack and defend against the infection in case of future exposure. Some vaccines require several doses to offer the most protection. timing matters. Like farming or taking care of your car, getting the right vaccine at the right time ensures that the process works. Years ago, it was not uncommon for children in their first 5 years to die or suffer the long-term consequences from vaccine-preventable diseases. Vaccines have helped change that. Immunization programs have been one of the single most effective public health interventions, saving millions of lives around the world in the last century. But even today, cases of vaccine-preventable diseases do occur and can spread in daycares and school settings. And that puts other children at risk of catching measles, mumps, rubella, whooping cough, and meningitis. Some children have to stay home, some might go to the hospital and go on antibiotics, and even in the worst case, suffer complications like paralysis, disability, deafness, blindness, and even death. Vaccines can help protect against these diseases and their complications. In 2014, measles outbreaks in southern Alberta and British Columbia in under-immunized communities resulted in dozens of confirmed cases and hundreds of scares before being declared over. You and your family can help protect your child by making sure everyone around them is up to date with their vaccines. By doing this, it helps form a cocoon of disease protection. Some parents are concerned that the number of vaccines may overburden babies' immune systems, but there really is no evidence to support this. Our immune systems are constantly exposed to new challenges in our everyday environment. Exposure to vaccines is just a tiny part of what a baby's immune system needs to face, and babies can handle them easily. The side effects of vaccines, like temporary pain or mild flu-like symptoms, are pretty minor when compared to the worst-case outcomes of not vaccinating. Serious allergic reactions from vaccines are very rare and are reported immediately to Public Health Agency of Canada so that any problems can be dealt with quickly. So what else is in vaccines? Well, vaccines also contain very small amounts of other ingredients, and all of which play necessary roles. These ingredients help vaccines work better, longer and faster, stay sterile, and help maintain quality during storage at different temperatures. By sticking to the vaccination schedule set out by your doctor, your child's health is maintained without interruption so they can grow, learn new skills, and experience life. I get my kids vaccinated because I know the facts. And if you have doubts or questions, talk to your doctor or nurse. Get the medical facts from your doctor, ask questions, and understand what the research says.
That was a video by Immunize Canada on vaccine hesitancy. So how do vaccines work? And how safe are they? This clip by Immunize Canada called Vaccine Safety can answer these questions.
Vaccination protects us from diseases. Keeping your immunizations up to date will protect your family from disease and reduce its spread in your community. Let's look at how immunizations keep you healthy. Vaccination introduces a portion of a weakened bacteria or virus into the body, usually by injection. When your immune system goes to work, it's as if you were exposed to disease. But here's the difference. Virus or bacteria in a vaccine won't make you sick. Instead, the vaccine prepares your body with a defense. And because vaccines provide such a tiny amount of virus or bacteria in an injection, getting more than one vaccine at the same time won't overwhelm your immune system. Dead or weakened viruses and bacteria are the main ingredients in vaccines. But vaccines may also contain adjuvants to help the body's immune system respond better to vaccines, and additives and preservatives to maintain the quality and effectiveness of vaccines over time. These ingredients are safe. In fact, many of them can be found in the foods we eat or in nature. Canadian laws and regulations set high standards for vaccine development, safety, and testing. Canada also has strong health systems to oversee and monitor vaccines as they arrive on the market and are sold to the public. Vaccines are safe. Talk to your doctor, nurse, pharmacist, or public health office about keeping your family's immunizations up to date. To learn more, visit immunize.ca.
That was Vaccine Safety by Immunize Canada. That can be found on YouTube. There has been some question about the MMR vaccine and its link with autism since Andrew Wakefield brought it up in 1998. Up next is a mythbuster for the link between autism and the MMR vaccine.
Mythbusters!
The World Health Organization explains that the 1998 study, which raised concerns about a possible link between measles, mumps, rubella, or MMR vaccine and autism was later found to be seriously flawed and fraudulent. The paper was subsequently retracted by the journal that published it. Unfortunately, its publication set off a panic that led to dropping immunization rates and subsequent outbreaks of these diseases. There is no evidence of a link between MMR vaccine and autism or autistic disorders. In fact, a case-control study done by researchers published in the Pediatric Infectious Disease Journal in 2010 provides evidence against the association of autism with either MMR or a single measles vaccine. Further, finding the risk connected with being vaccinated before the onset of first symptoms of autism was lower with the MMR vaccine. The authors theorize this may be due to some other confounding factors in their health status. For example, healthcare workers or parents may have noticed signs of developmental delay or disease before the actual autism diagnosis, and for this reason have avoided the vaccination. And in more exciting recent news, there was a nationwide cohort study done in Denmark and published in the Annals of Internal Medicine in 2019. The researchers concluded the study strongly supports that MMR vaccination does not increase the risk for autism, does not trigger autism in susceptible children, and is not associated with clustering of autism cases after vaccination. It adds to previous studies through significant additional statistical power and by addressing hypothesis of susceptible subgroups and clustering of cases. So why do British Columbians immunize against measles, mumps, and rubella? According to HealthLinkBC, measles, mumps, and rubella are diseases caused by viruses. Viruses are easily spread through the air when an infected person coughs or sneezes. You can become infected when you breathe in air or touch surfaces contaminated with the virus. The viruses can also be spread through contact with an infected person's saliva, such as by sharing food, drinks, or cigarettes, or even by kissing a loved one with the virus. Measles, also known as red measles, causes fever, rash, cold-like symptoms, and red inflamed eyes that can be sensitive to light. It can lead to infections of the ear or lungs, such as pneumonia. One of the more serious complications, which occurs in 1 out of every 1,000 cases, is encephalitis, which is an inflammation of the brain. This can lead to seizures, deafness, or permanent brain damage. About 1 person in every 3,000 cases with measles can die from these complications. Mumps causes fever, headaches, and swelling of the salivary glands and cheeks. More serious complications includes encephalitis, which is that swelling of the brain, and 1 in 20 people with mumps gets mumps meningitis, an infection of the lining of the brain. Mumps can also cause temporary deafness. Permanent deafness occurs in less than 1 in 20,000 people with mumps. About 1 in every 4 adult men and teenage boys develop painful swelling of the testicles. Rubella, also known as German measles, can cause serious complications and birth defects in an unborn baby, including deafness, eye problems, heart defects, liver damage, and brain damage. This is called congenital rubella syndrome. It occurs in about 9 out of 10 babies born to women who became infected with the virus in the first 3 months of their pregnancy. Rubella can also cause miscarriage or stillbirth. These diseases are now rare in BC because of the routine childhood immunization programs. If you have any questions or concerns about vaccine safety, contact your local public health unit or your family physician for evidence-informed answers. Armed with credible and reliable information, Tyson and Don, who had not vaccinated their children, had a change of heart. Here's their story. This is A Change of Heart from Immunize BC.
I'm My name's Dawn. I'm a mom of two boys. They are age 6 and almost 3. I have a husband and we live in East Vancouver.
Me and my wife we consider ourselves to be fairly natural parents. We do a lot of things different than our parents did with us and our grandparents did with our parents. And we have a lot of friends who are part of the natural parenting community. I didn't know a whole lot about vaccines before really looking into it.
Hearing word of mouth from somebody that says, well, you know, are you sure you want to vaccinate?
I started looking into it once my wife got pregnant, did all the research on the internet.
Type in a kind of non-specific tag word and all this comes up of why not to vaccinate. Oh my goodness, what are we going to do?
I can absolutely relate with people who are concerned about vaccines. I mean, being a parent isn't easy. And when it comes to vaccines, it always seems easier to not do something rather than to do something.
The research I was looking at was really fear-based, and it was really scary what I was reading, and I just felt like I couldn't inject my baby with these toxic chemicals. How could I do that?
The anti-vax information is so much easier to get because they're just so much louder. The scientific research, it's there. It's on paper, on like the CDC websites and the WHO websites. The anti-vax community, I've come to realize, they use a lot more flashy tactics.
It starts with a friend, concerned friend usually, and it's, you know, ends with getting the wrong information.
We did decide to vaccinate our second child, mostly because we went back and re-researched it with enough reading. I was like, oh, okay, well, it's possible I was wrong before.
When we looked at it with different eyes, we realized that we'd been misinformed, basically.
So I had become a better researcher over those couple of years, and I knew where to look for better information.
Looking at both sources and seeing, you know, why are they different?
We were realizing that the risks of the vaccines themselves are so small, yet the risks of getting these diseases the vaccines protect against are so great.
Compare them, like who has your child's best interest at heart, and you know, go with that side. If I could do it again, I would have done it so differently.
Yes, vaccines are good, vaccines are safe. They're one of the safest things you're gonna do with your children. I'm way more confident in their health now than I was before.
I feel confident with our kids going out in the world and not getting all the diseases out there that some people are vulnerable to.
Because when you're not vaccinating, it still is in the back of your head that your children are unprotected.
You can totally be a natural parent in a natural family and still vaccinate, eating healthy foods, listen to when they cry, pick them up. It's so good to know that, you know, I've done everything I can to make them as healthy as possible.
That was A Change of Heart from Immunize BC. Tyson and Dawn's experiences with vaccinations and their family. If you're just tuning in, you're listening to A Sound Constitution on CHLY 101.7 FM. Immunizations, is it worth a shot? On March 9th, 2019, CTV News reported that Island Health has confirmed 2 cases of pertussis, also known as whooping cough, on Vancouver Island. So what is whooping cough? According to HealthLinkBC, whooping cough is a highly contagious disease caused by bacteria that causes very severe coughing that can last for months. During bursts of violent coughing, you may make a noise that sounds like a whoop when you try to take a breath. You can cough so hard that you hurt a rib. Most recover with no problems, but there can be complications such as pneumonia. The illness can be dangerous in older adults and young children, especially babies who are not old enough to have had the pertussis vaccine yet. So this is what pertussis sounds like. When someone with whooping cough coughs, sneezes or laughs, tiny drops of fluid holding the bacteria are put into the air. The bacteria can infect others when people breathe in the drops or get them on their hands and touch their mouth or nose. After the bacteria infects someone, the symptoms appear about 7 to 14 days later. Symptoms of whooping cough may occur in three stages, especially in young children. Adults and older children may not follow this pattern of symptoms. In stage one, the symptoms are very much like a cold. You may experience sneezing or runny nose, a mild cough, watery eyes, and sometimes a mild fever. The symptoms last for several days to 2 weeks, and this is when you're most likely to spread the disease. In stage two, the cold symptoms get better, but the cough gets worse. The cough goes from a mild, dry, hacking cough to a severe cough that you can't control. You may cough so long and hard that you can't breathe. When you can take a breath of air, it may make that whooping noise that we heard earlier. After a coughing fit, you may vomit and feel very tired. Between coughing fits, you may feel normal. Symptoms are most severe in this stage. They usually last 2 to 4 weeks or longer. In stage three, you still have symptoms, but you feel better and grow stronger. The cough may get louder. Coughing fits may happen off and on for weeks. Coughing fits may flare up if you get a cold or have a similar illness. This stage may last longer if you have never had the vaccine. Adults and older children usually have milder symptoms than young children and infants. How bad your symptoms are also depends on whether you've had the vaccine and how long ago it was. Symptoms of whooping cough usually last 6 to 10 weeks overall, but it can actually last longer. Whooping cough is usually treated with antibiotics, but making sure that you and your children are immunized against whooping cough is the best way to prevent the whooping cough. Washing your hands often and staying away from people who have a bad cough may also help you avoid getting the disease. Up next is Bullets from Dope Soda, a local Vancouver Island band, on their album Carbonation. Then Sinaz will be telling us about childhood immunizations.
When the boat arrives, well, there won't be room for everyone. Oh. Everyone, oh, 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 oh.
the boat arrives, well, there won't be room for everyone. Oh,
that was Bullets from Dope Soda on their album Carbonation. If you're just tuning in, you're listening to A Sound Constitution on CHLY 101.7 FM. Immunizations, is it worth a shot? Up next, we'll be talking about childhood immunizations with Sanaz.
Hello, CHLY listeners. This is Sanaz. In this segment, we are going to talk about children immunization. According to Immunize.bc, vaccinating children is one of the most important things that parents can do to protect their children's health. Young children are especially vulnerable to vaccine-preventable disease because their immune system are less mature and therefore less able to fight off infection. In infants and young children, these diseases can cause serious illness, long-term disability, and even death. Vaccines provide the best and safest protection against them. Learn about what vaccines your child needs and when, why our child needs to get vaccinated on time, and how to prepare for a better immunization experience. Now let's talk about why your child needs to get vaccinated on time. For best protection against disease, it's advised that children get vaccinated on time starting at 2 months of age and that they follow the recommended schedule as closely as possible. Infants and young children are at greater risk for vaccine-preventable disease because their immune system are less mature and less able to fight off infection. If an infant or young child were to get a vaccine-preventable disease, it could be very serious and life-threatening. Vaccinating children on time gives them the best protection as early as possible. According to Centers for Disease Control and Prevention, children are given vaccines at a young age because this is when they are at highest risk of getting sick or dying if they get these diseases. Newborn babies are immune to some diseases because they have antibodies they get from their mothers, usually before they are born. However, this immunity lasts a few months. Most babies do not get protective antibodies against diphtheria, whooping cough, polio, tetanus, hepatitis B, or HIP from their mothers. This is why it's important to vaccinate a child before she or he is exposed to a disease. Vaccines contain weakened or killed versions of the germs that cause a disease. These elements of vaccines and other molecules and microorganisms that stimulate the immune system are called antigens. Babies are exposed to thousands of germs and other antigens in the environment from the time they are born. When a baby is born, his or her immune system is ready to respond to the many antigens in the environment and the selected antigens in vaccines. Now we are going to talk about pain management during immunization for children. According to Immunize Canada, immunization are a routine part of medical care during childhood. The pain caused by vaccinations can be upsetting, causing unnecessary stress and anxiety for some children and their parents, who may then delay or avoid vaccinations, leaving their children without protection from serious disease. Parents play an important role in supporting their children during immunizations. Here are some tips you can use to help reduce the stress, anxiety, and pain when it comes to immunization in children under 3 years of age. What you can do is to breastfeed your child. If you are breastfeeding your baby, start to breastfeed your baby before vaccination. Make sure you have a good latch, then continue breastfeeding during and after the vaccination. Breastfeeding combines holding, sweet taste, and sucking, and is one of the best ways to reduce pain in babies. Breastfeeding during vaccination is safe for babies, even newborns. There is no evidence that babies will choke or associate their mother with pain. Undress your baby to free the leg or arm where the needle will be given before you start breastfeeding. If your child cannot be breastfed, you may bottle feed your child or give a soother before, during, and after vaccination. Position your child upright and hold your child close before, during, and after the needle. This helps your child to feel secure and to stay still. Sit on a chair to minimize the risk of accidental falls. Don't hold your child too tightly. This can increase pain and distress. As parents, your state of mind is really important too. Try to stay calm. Use your normal speaking voice. and be positive before, during, and after the vaccination. This will help your baby to stay calm. Children see and feel what their parents are doing and often do the same. If you are nervous, you can take a few slow, deep breaths to calm yourself. Breathe so your belly expands, not your chest. You can do this while holding your child. Distracting your child is also another way that can help you. Taking your child's focus away from the pain can reduce your child's pain. While holding your child close, distract with singing or talking. For babies, breastfeeding is ideal for sucking. A soother may be used with or without sugar water if you are not breastfeeding. Allow baby to suck breastfeeding or soother before, during, and after a vaccination. Add rocking your child back and forth after the vaccination. You may choose to distract an older child with toys such as bubbles, pop-up books, rattles, or smartphones. If toys do not work, hold your child close and distract with singing or talking. Remember, combining the different methods together lead to even better results.
Thank you, Sanaz, for that information. According to the British Columbia government website on their BC government news page, the province is launching a measles immunization catch-up program to help BC families ensure their children are protected from measles. The program will run from April through June 2019. Andrew Dix, the Minister of Health, has said, "With outbreaks of measles occurring globally and here in BC, we know we will see the threats of further outbreaks and can be doing more to raise immunization rate. That is why we are launching a catch-up program to immunize children from kindergarten to grade 12 who have not previously been immunized against measles and to provide a dose for those who may not have received both doses. The goal of the program is to immunize as many people as possible before the end of the school year and hopefully reach an immunization rate of 95% as recommended. Health authorities will be the ones delivering the program. The program will be available in schools to children from kindergarten to grade 12. Public health units, community health centers, and mobile community clinics in select regions. The program will be delivered similarly with some regional variations. By offering it in schools, public health units, and community health centers, the catch-up program is designed to make it simpler and stress-free for parents to ensure the children are adequately protected from measles. Pharmacists will also be part of the efforts to increase the immunization rates. For this catch-up campaign, the province is initially purchasing 3 million in vaccine, which is 1 year's supply of vaccines. The catch-up program is the first step in the government's two-phase plan to educate people about the importance of immunization and help them become aware of the immunization status. Offering measles immunization catch-up program now will also help prepare parents for the mandatory reporting of vaccination status, which is planned for the fall of 2019. Without a record of immunization or a proof of immunity to a disease, a person is considered unimmunized and unprotected and should generally be immunized or re-immunized to ensure protection. It is safe to repeat immunizations. Parents should check their children's immunization records to be sure they are up to date. If they are unsure or do not have the records handy, they can check with their primary care provider or public health unit. Parents can provide their children's records to their local public health unit for entry into the provincial immunization registry. If a child's current immunization record is already on file with the local health unit, parents do not need to provide it again. Health authorities will be working with schools to notify parents of the upcoming measles immunization catch-up clinics. Information about measles and what to expect if your child needs a measles immunization. Health authorities will contact families with under or unimmunized children through a variety of actions, including direct calling families, sending emails and letters, and working with schools on newsletters. To have your child vaccinated here in Nanaimo, you can contact the local Nanaimo Health Unit at 250-755-3342. They are located at 1665 Grant Avenue, right near the Nanaimo General Hospital. This is a Sound Constitution on CHLY 101.7 FM.
Up next is Good to You by Marianas Trench, a band from Vancouver from their album Masterpiece Theatre. Then Isaiah will be telling us about immunizations for adults.
Everyone's around, no words are coming now, and I can't find my breath. Can we just say the rest with no sound? And I know this isn't enough, I still don't measure up, and I'm not prepared. Sorry is never there when you need it. And I do want you to know I'll hold you up above everyone. And I do want you to know I think that you'd be good to me, and I'd be so good to you.
Between someone I just invented, who I really am.
That was Good to You by Marianas Trench, a band from Vancouver. Their album, Masterpiece Theatre. If you're just tuning in, you're listening to A Sound Constitution on CHLY 101.7 FM. Immunizations, is it worth the shot? Up next is Isaiah with Adult Immunizations.
You're listening to A Sound Constitution. You may or may not know, vaccines are not just for kids. According to BC Immunizations, adults need routine vaccinations to ensure optimal health as well. Additionally, some lines of work may require vaccinations prior to work engagement or consistently throughout your employment. Another potentially little-known fact is that those shots you got as a kid, well, some of them require booster shots to maintain their efficacy or work at all. ImmunizeBC at immunizebc.ca/public health unit Nanaimo says, some diseases are more common in adults. As you get older, your risk for certain diseases increases, such as shingles and pneumococcal disease. ImmunizeBC also says protection from some vaccines can wear off over time. As you get older, the protection from some vaccines you received at a younger age can wear off. Booster doses are needed to ensure continued protection. For example, a booster dose of tetanus diphtheria, or TD vaccine, is recommended for adults every 10 years. Your age, lifestyle, job, travel plans, or health condition may put you at risk for new and different diseases. For example, adults who work in healthcare settings or who have multiple sex partners are at risk for hepatitis B.
adults with certain chronic health conditions are at risk for pneumococcal disease, and adults who are traveling internationally may be at risk for diseases we don't see here in Canada. To protect people of all ages, scientists are working hard to develop new vaccines. For example, the HPV vaccine and shingles vaccine, or human papillomavirus, are both fairly new vaccines and are recommended for some adults. Even new vaccines have been studied for a long time and are known to be safe. Immunizations BC says that when you get vaccinated, you help protect others too. When you get vaccinated, you help protect others by making it less likely that you will get and spread a disease. This helps protect those who can't be vaccinated, such as very young babies and people with certain medical conditions. Some vaccines are routinely recommended for all adults. Others may be recommended for you depending on your age, job, lifestyle, health conditions, travel plans, and vaccines you received in the past. On the BC Immunizations website, there are certain vaccines recommended for all adults. BC Immunizations says the following vaccines are routinely recommended for all adults at certain points in their life. Some of these vaccines are publicly funded, which means they're free, and others may need to be purchased. Here are some of them: tetanus and diphtheria, tetanus, diphtheria, and pertussis, which is Tdap, shingles vaccine, pneumococcal polysaccharide vaccine, and the influenza vaccine. Other vaccines you may need, according to Immunizations BC, you may also need other vaccines as an adult depending on your age, health conditions, job, lifestyle, travel plans, and the vaccines you received in the past. Some are provided for free, and others may need to be purchased. Talk to your healthcare provider about which vaccines are recommended for you. If you missed getting an immunization at childhood, there are some recommended vaccines for you as an adult. Where can you get vaccinated? It's really easy to find where you can get vaccinated. Research Nanaimo Health Unit for more information on vaccinations. And additionally, if you are seeking guidance on vaccinations or want to learn more, speak to your physician or primary health care provider, as they will have a record of your vaccination history. Or they can refer you to the appropriate location to have all your vaccinations updated or find your vaccination history. According to Immunization BC, keeping track of your immunizations is a responsibility of yours. Keep your record in a safe place with other medical information or identity documents. However, if you don't do this, then you can ask your physician where to locate it. Additionally, if you've had to submit it to a previous or current work engagement, then they should have a copy available for you as well. Just make sure that it's current and up to date. So, some people feel a little anxiety regarding immunization appointments. Here's some tips for before, during, and after to make it a little less nerve-wracking. Before your appointment, if you have access to your previous immunization records, locate them so you can bring them to your appointment. During your appointment, don't be afraid to ask questions. It's your right to know what's going on and how it's happening. And if you have previous allergies or you have allergies that your physician may not know about, tell your healthcare provider. But if they aren't aware, it's a good idea to have them ready so that you can let them know. And after your appointment, the person administering your vaccines will always ask you to stay in the facility for up to 15 minutes. This is due to the extremely rare possibility of having an allergic reaction called anaphylaxis. The chances of this occurring, though, are roughly 1 in 100,000 to 1 in a million. And if this does occur, the location you're receiving your immunizations from is prepared to treat this reaction. Here are some tips for a more positive immunization experience, according to Vaccinations BC. Pain or fear associated with vaccinations can cause stress and anxiety for many adults, causing some delay or avoid them altogether. Below are some tips you can use to help reduce stress, anxiety, and discomfort associated with immunizations. Here are some tips you can use to help reduce stress, anxiety, and the discomfort associated with immunizations. Sit upright. Unless you have a history of fainting, if this is the case, let your healthcare provider know. This will help promote a sense of control. Take deep breaths, breathe in slowly so your belly expands, and then exhale slowly. Relax your arms well. It may help to dangle your arm beside you to ensure that your muscle is relaxed. Distract yourself to take your attention away, listening to music, watching videos, reading, or talking to your healthcare provider or someone else can all help to distract you. Additionally, you can buy topical anesthetics to help reduce the pain at the site of injection. Also, Healthcare providers providing immunizations are usually pretty good at doing their own distraction techniques. For instance, they'll usually talk to you. This information is provided by 2019 BC Centre for Disease Control and BC Immunizations on the British Columbia Health website. This has been Isaiah with a Sound Constitution. Here is Kristen.
So, are you thinking about going on a backpacking trip around Europe? How about checking out some ancient ruins in South America? Well, did you know that you may need vaccines for your globe-trotting adventures? Just because you may have your vaccines up to date, doesn't mean you won't need additional ones when you're traveling out of the country. Immunize Canada states that there are a number of illnesses and diseases not commonly found here in Canada, but are in other parts of the world. The most common ones requiring vaccines are hepatitis A, measles, and yellow fever. The Government of Canada recommends you visit your healthcare provider or travel health clinic 6 weeks before your planned trip. This is important as it can take several weeks for your immune system to fully develop immunity, and some vaccines may need to be given in more than one dose. It is important to note that some countries also require you to have proof of vaccination prior to entering the country. The most common vaccination that countries require proof of are yellow fever, meningitis, and polio. Yellow fever is the more commonly inquired about vaccine, and the Government of Canada has a list on where yellow fever may occur and countries requiring proof of vaccination. However, it is best to check with the embassy or consulate with your destination country to verify. Before you travel, be sure to check out travel health notices posted by the Government of Canada for the risk of diseases in your destination country. A link to this list will be provided on our Facebook page. So, where can you go to get more information about your vaccination history? Well, be sure to check with your healthcare provider for the most up-to-date list. Also, here in Nanaimo, there is a travel medicine and vaccination clinic in which you can book an appointment and they will help you in identifying the vaccines needed based on your destination country. Check out their website at tmvc.com or call them at 1-888-288-8682. Links to the travel medicine and vaccination clinic and the Government of Canada will be provided on our Facebook page after the show. So, in order to enjoy your travel destination and not their hospitals, as pretty as they may be sure to be updated on your vaccinations and health. To illustrate on how diseases in other parts of the world can still affect us here in Canada, here's a TED Talk from Bruce Aylward called How We Will Stop Polio for Good.
I want to share with you over the next 18 minutes a pretty incredible idea. Actually, it's a really big idea. But to get us started, I want to ask if everyone can just close your eyes for 2 seconds and try and think of a technology or a bit of science that you think has changed the world. Now, I bet in this audience, you're thinking of some really incredible technology, some stuff that I haven't even heard of, I'm absolutely sure. But I'm also sure, pretty sure, that absolutely nobody is thinking of this. This is a polio vaccine. And it's a great thing, actually, that nobody's had to think about it here today, because it means that we can take this for granted. This is a great technology, we can take it completely for granted. But it wasn't always that way. Even here in California, if we were to go back just a few years, it was a very different story. People were terrified of this disease. They were terrified of polio, and it would cause public panic. And it was because of scenes like this. In this scene, people are living in an iron lung. These are people who were perfectly healthy 2 or 3 days before, and then 2 days later, they can no longer breathe, and this polio virus has paralyzed not only their arms and their legs, but also their breathing muscles. And they were going to spend the rest of their lives, usually, in this iron lung to breathe for them. This disease was terrifying. There was no cure, and there was no vaccine. The disease was so terrifying that the President of the United States launched an extraordinary national effort to find a way to stop it. 20 years later, they succeeded. and developed the polio vaccine. It was hailed as a scientific miracle in the late 1950s, finally a vaccine that could stop this awful disease. And here in the United States, it had an incredible impact. As you can see, the virus stopped, and it stopped very, very fast. But this wasn't the case everywhere in the world. And it happened so fast in the United States, however, that even just last month, John Stewart said this.
Where is polio still active? Because I thought that had been eradicated in the way that smallpox had been eradicated.
Oops. John, polio has almost been eradicated. But the reality is that polio still exists today. We made this map for John to try and show him exactly where polio still exists. This is the picture. There's not very much left in the world. But the reason there's not very much left is because there's been an extraordinary public-private partnership working behind the scenes, almost unknown, I'm sure, to most of you here today. It's been working for 20 years to try and eradicate this disease. And it's got it down to this few cases that you can see here on this graphic. But just last year, we had an incredible shock and realized that almost just isn't good enough with a virus like polio. And this is the reason. In two countries that hadn't had this disease for more than probably a decade, on opposite sides of the globe, there was suddenly terrible polio outbreaks. Hundreds of people were paralyzed, hundreds of people died, children as well as adults. And in both cases, we were able to use genetic sequencing to look at the polio viruses, and we could tell these viruses were not from these countries. They had come from thousands of miles away, and in one case, it originated on another continent. And not only that, but when they came into these countries, then they got on commercial jetliners, probably, and they traveled even further to other places, like Russia, where for the first time in over a decade last year, children were crippled and paralyzed by a disease that they had not seen for years. Now, all of these outbreaks that I just showed you, these are under control now, and it looks like they'll probably stop very, very quickly. But the message was very clear. Polio is still a devastating, explosive disease. It's just happening in another part of the world. And our big idea is that the scientific miracle of this decade should be the complete eradication of poliomyelitis. So I want to tell you a little bit about what this partnership, the polio partnership, is trying to do. We're not trying to control polio. We're not trying to get it down to just a few cases, because this disease is like a root fire. It can explode again if you don't snuff it out completely. So what we're looking for is a permanent solution. We want a world in which every child, just like you guys, can take for granted a polio-free world. So we're looking for a permanent solution. And this is where we get lucky. This is one of the very few viruses in the world where there are big enough cracks in its armor that we can try and do something truly extraordinary. This virus can only survive in people. It can't live for a very long time in people. It doesn't survive in the environment hardly at all. And we've got pretty good vaccines, as I just showed you. So we are trying to wipe out this virus completely. What the polio eradication program is trying to do is to kill the virus itself that causes polio everywhere on Earth.
That was Bruce Aylward on his TED Talk, How Will We Stop Polio for Good?
Thank you, Kristen, for informing us about travel immunizations. For more information on immunizations, you can visit immunizebc.ca to get the most up-to-date information on immunizations in BC, or just call or visit your local public health unit. This was Immunizations. Are they worth a shot? On A Sound Constitution, CHLY 101.7 FM. Until next week.
As we come to the end of the episode, we encourage you to reach out to your healthcare practitioner and other health professionals for more information. We hope you enjoyed today's episode, and as always, check out our Facebook page for resources from today's show.
If there is anything you would like to hear us talk about, let us know by email at asoundconstitution@gmail.com. Thank you for listening to A Sound Constitution on CHLY 101.7 FM.